First of all, welcome to the show, Brendan.
Thanks very much.
The film itself, probably one of the more darker comedies you've worked on, I think. From the very first sentence that gets uttered by one of the main characters, it's a fairly hefty ride.
It is, yeah. No, we start as we mean to finish.
There's not a lot of preaching goes on, to be honest, in the film. You don't really sort of spend that much time telling people what to do. It's just kind of a community who've kind of...
No, just reacting badly when they do it. No, it's true. I mean, yeah, it's... I don't know. He basically soaks up people's disillusionment and cynicism. That's what he does. He soaks it up. He doesn't judge them over it. He absorbs it and counters it.
Yeah.
Or attempts to. And I'm not sure if the people don't care about him. I think they actually do care about him. But they want to break him because it will validate their own cynicism and their own disillusionment.
Yeah.
And at the same time, I don't believe they really want him to break.
No.
They want the opposite to happen. So there's an odd dynamic going on where the people, he's kind of recognised universally as being a good man, or at least attempting to be a good man. But they, if they believe in that, it compromises their own safe cynicism.
Yeah. Growing up, did you have the experience of a strong kind of figure within the church?
Yeah, I did, yeah. I went to a Christian Brothers school, which is like the Irish Christian Brothers of... had to answer a fair amount of accusation over the last few years, but I had a very young Christian brother, Pat Grogan, in Marino Primary School, that, you know, I just mentioned over the weekend, he had the bravery to allow creativity to be a normal thing. You know, he used to come in with bunches of poster paints and have us paint and stuff and bringing us up the mountains, showing us mountains and putting concerts on in school and stuff like that in a Christian Brothers school where really academic achievement was the order of the day, and that was the ethos. So he was huge, profound sort of influence on me in the sense that for a number of years in primary school, I fairly felt it was okay to want to be creative.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like when you do, I guess in the end I was batting for him a fair amount of the time, I guess, in this film without particularly realising it or basing anything especially on it. I think it's an institution and it has grown... in need of repair, put it that way, put it very loosely like that.
Yeah.
It's become, any institution that has power at the centre of it and all that is going to be corrupted over the years. There's no question about it. It has to be. Even if it's something that is supposed to be the quintessential good institution, an institution of its nature because of the humanity in it is going to corrupt itself. It has to. And so therefore they're trying to keep it swept is really important. So I hope this is not just about Catholicism. I think this priest takes on the fact that he's wearing that uniform and that he has to answer to it.
Yeah.
And it's about how he gets on in that. But I think it's about something a little more profound and less parochial even than the Irish question or the Catholic question. I think it's about a world, well, certainly a European or a Western world problem with what to believe in.
Yeah.
As against, we know what we don't believe in, we know what we don't tolerate, we know what's wrong about everything, but do we know what's right about anything?
Yeah. You taught the Irish language for quite a while. Do you kind of get the feeling of making people realise that you can't just throw the baby out with the bathwater? There is something,
I think
good
it's about,
at the end of it.
I think it's about babies and bathwater. You can throw it out if you want. It's not, it's like, it's up to yourself, but it's a question of what you replace it with. And it's about, progressing the human condition a little bit in terms of saying, okay, well, we have to refine that then, or we have to actually just dump it.
Yeah.
But if we're dumping it, it was filling a void of whatever nature. First of all, you need to try to understand the need, even if you don't fully understand the void. And then find out what will take its place. And in terms of how do you define that particular goodness of humanity that will allow you to feel optimistic and feel like striving and aspiring to things.
The characters that you kind of find yourself in the middle of, is it a testament to the actors that represent them? These fairly horrible characters, they're still kind of grounded in very human depictions, I suppose.
Well, most of them are speaking the truth.
Yeah.
Most of them are speaking the truth, if not all of them are speaking the truth. Not all of them.
But not the one played by your son, presumably.
That was one particular thing I had in mind. And it was about, is it about manufacturing a truth, or did he actually believe that? Well, I don't know. But essentially most of the people, what their argument is almost irrefutable. So It's the vigor with which they pursue. It's like saying, see, now I've found out that you're bogus, you know, that your organization is bogus, that everything you espouse is hypocritical. And that's where they reach a little bit of a problem, because this guy tries not to be hypocritical.
Yeah.
Even if by wearing a particular uniform that compromises the situation. So that's where the dynamic is, that it's a kind of continuous engagement with that, with two different truths.
Finally, for now, what's next for you? You went on a film about the suffragettes, I believe.
Yeah, we're on the suffragette at the moment. Okay. So that's really exciting.
Yeah, it went with Meryl Streep.
Fantastic bunch of women, yeah, it's brilliant. And, well, she came over and played Mrs. Pankhurst. It was good, really good. But Kerry Mulligan and Anne-Marie Duff and Helena Bonham Carter and Ben Whishall.
It's not represented a heck of a lot in film, is it, really?
No, and I don't know about that many statues that are up either.
No.
Like, it's interesting, you know, it's one of the things when I came to London first, I noticed how many soldiers are up on plinths.
Yeah.
And there aren't really many suffragettes up on plinths. It's kind of odd. But we've got to work in the Houses of Parliament. I don't know how they pulled that one, but I have a funny feeling there was an inherent accusation of misogynism. So we got in there for the first time since the 1950s.
You didn't have to hide when it all shut down.
It's really great. So we're in there at the moment, just filming. So that's fascinating. No, brilliant. I think it is time for reassessment. And about all of that, and also the achievements of it. It's been interesting talking about that.
Yeah.
So it's been pretty cool, and I'm playing a guy who is doing work that is not particularly sympathetic. I'm playing a CID man who was kind of using cameras for the first time to photograph people on the street and try to make people turn informant and all that kind of stuff. But it's an interesting, he's been allowed to have a personality that is there for the taking, maybe. So that's been really fantastic as well.
Awesome.
Meryl Streep came in and said, "Ah, the villain," and I was able to say,
"It's not a black and white. Come on, now, Meryl."
No, it's kind of, but it is good like that. It's been great, really, really great, and really collaborative. And I think they're having a ball.
Yeah,
yeah,
super, Brendan. Thank you so much for talking to us.
Thanks.
Have a great day.
Cheers.